I was discussing in previous class about the problem how our lexical analyzer will distinguish or differentiate between keywords and identifiers. You know, first solution I already told you, the first method, that is you know, we are using symbol table, which is playing a very important role. In fact, our all phases of our compilation process or compilation phases, they will communicate with this symbol table. Okay, so here in symbol table, as its name itself is a symbol table, symbols will be keep on inserting, right? So which symbols are inserting there, you know, on which programming language you are writing the program, okay, or code or your source program. So in that programming language already, how many keywords are there? Those all keywords should be already pre-stored in this symbol table. Okay, so if you by mistake, if you declare any variable with the same keyword as a variable, then that will be accepted, but it will be accepted as a variable, not definitely by not as a keyword, because already the keywords are present there. Then lexical analyzer will understand that, oh, this is a it will compare this variable with the already entered symbol table entries. So if it is found there, then easily it will understand that so already present entry is a keyword, and now whatever the new input is coming to me, it is a variable or identifier. Like this, it will make the clear differentiation. Okay, so that is the first solution. Second solution is, for each and every keyword, you have to draw the transition diagram. So after drawing the transition diagram for these keywords, so what you have to do is, after the last character of that keyword, so you have to make one test or one check. Okay, so that test is whether after this last character, again the characters are coming here, or other any non-letters are coming here. It means like any underscore or something, any symbol is coming, or something is coming here, or what, or any digits are coming here, or what. So if it is coming there, then it will understand that so this is not at all a keyword, this is definitely a variable. Okay, so if after this last character n, if nothing is there, then if nothing is there, then it will clearly identify, or it will clearly recognize this then as a keyword, because of course then is a keyword. After n, something is not found, it will identify or recognize it as a keyword. If something will come here after n, then it will identify it as a variable. One best example I show you, just wait here, see here, then, it is a token, right? So this then is a lexeme. This lexeme will be found only when after n nothing is there. For example, if you have declared one variable like this, then extvalue, so it will keep on scanning this input characters then. Okay, after n, if something characters are continuing like this, then immediately it will understand that it is not a keyword, it is a identifier. So like this method also we can adopt, but now we have not adopted this method since it is a hectic job for drawing or considering a transition diagram for each and every keyword. Okay, so instead of that only, we have adopted this first method, that is using a symbol table method. So then, because we have not adopted this method, because of that only here, we have not numbered these states here, only circles I have shown here. Okay, in fact, we can write the numbers here, don't worry, we could write, but why I have not written, it is just to show you how that second method works. I just we have drawn this diagram here, simply instead of writing the state names here or state numbers, we have not written them here, simply we have taken as a nodes here, as a circle. Okay, so since we are not going to adopt them at all. Okay, then next small topic is completion of the running example. What is our running example? You know, our running example is identifying a branching statements, if and if then, if else statements, right? So already in the first topic of today's morning class, just now I told you, so how to write the grammar for it, after that how to write the patterns for that, and after that I have even written the transition diagram for one token, that is a relational operator, and I have written one relational transition diagram for a keyword, and one transition diagram for identifier. So these all things we have done now. Now, if you observe there in our patterns, we have last one, this one is there, no, relational operator, right? So, relational operator definition, if you look into that relational operator definition, at LHS side, I have written, it means, for example, not relational operator, sorry, that is expression, EXPR. So, left side it is a EXPR, and right side it was a term followed by relational operator followed by term. Now, I am going to define that term. What is term? Term also I defined in that grammar. How term look like? Term looks like ID or else it will be a number. It means it will be either identifier or else it will be a number. For example, for the relational operator less than, the expression may be A less than B, which is identifier. Okay, A and B are identifiers. The same regular relational operator less than can be like this also. 3 is less than 5. So here the terms are nothing but here numbers. And particularly here I have taken integer numbers in my example. They may be floating point numbers also, exponential numbers also. Okay. So now the last task of our example is we have to draw the transition diagram for numbers now, because already identifier is completed, keyword is completed, relational operator is completed, right? Now the time is to draw the transition diagram for number. Okay, so which is a complicated transition diagram? Most of the times they will ask you guys these all things. They will ask you to draw the transition diagram for identifier, transition diagram for a keyword, transition diagram for relational operator, transition diagram for number. Okay, so here we have drawn the transition diagram for number. Okay, so you know, again we are continuing our transition diagram of a previous diagram. Here we are extending it, or we are continuing it here. So that is a state number 12. I begin from the state number 12 because I think in last transition diagram that final state was there, that state was I think 11. Now I am continuing it with the 12. So initial state it is, and first you can see here one digit is there, and number will be like this only. It may be only one digit, okay, like 3, 5 or something. Okay, it may be only single digit. After that digit, if something is not present there, or something is present like a semicolon or colon something, then you could directly go to the last state, that is final state 20, and you can return it as a digit and attribute value also, which is that digit, that also you can return. Next, one more possibility is there. There may not be always only one single digit, right? So there may be many number of a sequence of digits, like our phone number, bank account number, something. So this digit will be keep on followed by n number of digits. Okay, so after that digit, if there is nothing is there, then again it will go to the last state, that is 20. Clear? So there are some possibilities are there. After some sequence of digits, there may be followed by one dot. If a dot occurs there, that is optional fraction, it is not compulsory. If you are working on a floating point number, then only this will happen. So then you have to move to the state 14. After dot, again there will be some digits. Okay, single digit may be present or multiple number of digits may be present. After these multiple number of digits, there may be nothing, then you will return that floating point value. Okay, in a state number 21. Then one more possibility is there, and optional exponential value may be present there. So after some digits, again there may be one capital E and followed by capital E and followed by some digit or digits, then you will return that exponential value. And after E, not directly digits are appearing. Sometimes there may be some symbols like plus or minus. After that, digits may be present. So then it will reach the last final state 19 and it will return it. So here totally 3 states are final states here, 19, 20 and 21. So this is a very perfect transition diagram for our numbers, guys. It will cover, it will match every number, even it is integer number or floating point value or number, and it is a fractional number or else it is an exponential number. Okay, so this is the transition diagram for a number. Very complex and somewhat confusing is there, but nothing is there. Once you understand it, nothing is there. First you focus on a digit, and that also single digit and multiple number of digits, then followed by a dot, which is a fractional, which is a fraction, which is optional. Then after dot, there may be some single or multiple number of digits. Then again go to the final state and return that floating point value. Then suppose after that digits also some characters like e and plus or minus are there. So these are about exponential. Very easy actually, don't worry. Okay, so once you understand, it will be very easy for you. Don't get confusion. And but most of the times they will ask you to draw these all transition diagrams in your exam. Keep it in your mind. So let us see now the transition diagram for our white space, because in our programs we use white spaces also, right? So for that white space, a separate transition diagram we have to draw, that is from state number 22. Okay, state number 22 is a initial state, then a delimiter. Usually we call this space as a delimiter. I have written the name as a delimiter here, label as a delimiter. What do you mean by delimiter? General meaning I am going to tell you. Delimiter is nothing but it is any character which is going to separate two words. Okay, it may be space, it may be tab, or it may be new line character, or it may be comma, it may be underscore, it may be hyphen, it may be colon. So anything, any character which is separating two parts, separating into two parts, then it is called as a delimiter. So first delimiter, if it is only one space, okay, or one tab or one new line character, then I enter into 23rd state. After that, if nothing is there, like a tab, new line character or space, after that something else is there, it may be any character or any symbol is there, then I will enter into final state, that is 24. If multiple number of delimiters are there, then you will cover all those multiple number, or you will match all those delimiters, and then ultimately you will go to the other, then you will go to the final state. Clear guys? So these all are the transition diagrams for our branching statement. Clear now? So in a branching statement, we use if then else keywords. For these keywords, we have drawn one transition diagram, right? So then for identifiers also, we have drawn one transition diagram, which is the same as our transition diagram of keyword. Then we have drawn a transition diagram for earlier, actually first only we have drawn that one, that is a relational operator transition diagram. Then we have drawn a relational transition diagram for a number. Then we have drawn a transition diagram for white space also. So everything we have covered now. Okay, so last state is a 24 here, remember. So we started from state number 0 and we end with the state number 24. Okay, then next topic is last topic of this module, that is architecture of a lexical analyzer. Architecture of lexical analyzer, that is nothing but transition diagram based lexical analyzer it is particularly. Okay, so here it is using transition diagram. So architecture is nothing but here just we are going to write a software or code for this lexical analyzer. Okay, see here we have some variables in this code, that is a program for lexical analyzer. You know, in our first module you have written assemblers. Okay, assemblers nothing but you have written the code there, right? So at last topic you have written one bootstrap loader. That bootstrap loader you have written one software there, that is program, right? So similarly here we are going to write one small code for our lexical analyzer, and particularly for how it is going to look into these transition diagrams. Okay, for that particular one relational operator transition diagram we have written a small code. So it is called as lexical analyzer, and here we are going to use one variable state. What this state is going to do here, each state is represented by a piece of code. Remember, state number 0 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. In our first transition diagram, what I taught today for relational operator, the last state was state number 8, if you remember. Next transition diagram started from state number 9, right? Like this, you know, in our circle, in our node, whatever the state numbers we have written, for each and every state, we are going to write a small piece of code. Okay, remember it. So now here this state STAT, one separate variable also we are using in our code, and that state variable is used to store or hold the number of current state, state number 0, 1, 2, 3 or which state it is. Okay, so that state variable is used to store this number for our transition diagram. Then a switch based on the value of a state takes us to the code for each of the possible states. So you know, in our program we are going to use one switch statement, and inside that switch statement we have to pass one value for that variable state. Based on this value of a state only, this switch statement will switch to the particular state. So it may be a state number 0, it may be state number 8, it may be state number 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or something. Okay, and after reaching that state, it will take a particular action for that state. So let us see how it is. And here we are going to use one function also, that is get relational operator. Get relational operator is a function. Which function? We are going to write a C++ code. So it is a C++ function when job is to simulate the transition diagram and return an object of type token. It means it is going to return one object. It is going to return one object, and it is going to return that object of a type token, that is a pair of consisting of the token name. Okay, so then we must be a relational operator in this case and attribute value. Okay, here this token, of course it will be containing both a token name as well as a attribute value. Okay, so what is the token name here? Definitely it is a relop, and attribute value for this one will be the value, which is like less than, greater than, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, like this. Okay, so next one more function we use here, that is a next char. This function gets the next character from our inputs and it will assign it to the local variable. One local variable we are going to use here, that is a C variable. Whatever the input characters you are scanning, now one by one all those characters will be going to be assigned to this variable C. Okay, so then this is our lexical analyzer for the transition diagram for a relational operator. You can observe, guys, here very important and very interesting. Just now I told you this get relational operator function. So it is going to, this function is going to create one object here, right? So here you can see here, I told you here what is it is. This is going to return one object of a type token, right? So here this get relational operator, first it creates a new object, that object name is a return token, and it initializes this object to the first component to relational operator, that is a symbolic code for the token relational operator. Now here relational operator is a function which is going to create the object, new object, that is a return token. Okay, it is an object. Then here we are going to use one while loop, and inside that I have written one here. What do you mean by one? The while condition is always true. Its meaning is while condition is always true. Okay, then it means this loop will be keep on executing. And inside this while loop we have used one switch statement, and its variable for switch statement I have used state. Okay, so here the value of state will be either 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, like this up to 24, because in our transition diagrams of all our branching statement, 24 states are there. If you remember just now whatever I explained you, in that one particularly, don't worry, I am going to cover only in this code only first 8 or first 9 states here, because this code is written for only for the transition diagram of relational operator, where case number 8 was the last state. Okay, so case 0 is a C equal to next character. It means it will get the next character, and it will keep on comparing that character with these all symbols. So whether that character is less than, if it is true, then go to the state number 1. Else means what? It is not less than. If that character is equal to equal operator, then go to state number 5. If it is greater than, then go to the state number 6. like this, these all cases will be done here. Else means these are not present there. These are not present there, then else will be fail. It means it is not able to find out the lexeme. Lexeme is not a relational operator. It is something else. Okay. Relational operator will be always how they look like. They look like either less than, greater than, or equal to. Correct. So if these three cases are not satisfying there, these three conditions are not satisfying them, then definitely it is not a relational operator. Then it will go to the fail function. Okay. So then break. So if the state number is a 1, then it will go and it will check all those things which are starting from, I think you have moved to case number 1 only when your first character was less than there. Correct. Already you have scanned less than. After less than, what is there? Maybe equal mark. Okay. Maybe greater than or not equal to, or maybe any either identifier or digit. Okay. So that case you can take here in the case number 1. And here I am going to tell you about case number 8, that is retract. Retract means what it is. So after 8th final state, you should retract your forward pointer. You know, in your previous classes I told you lexeme begin pointer and forward pointer. It means that simply after less than, if you are observing equal mark, then it is less than or equal to. After less than, if you are observing greater than, then it is not equal to. Apart from these two, if you are observing anything, then it is a purely less than. So after equal to, after greater than, after that less than, anything is there, then instead of moving that pointer to next one, you come back and you identify it as a perfect lexeme. Okay, retract meaning is that only. Don't forward that pointer to the next character, next character, next character like this only. You retract it. You come back and you make it as a, or identify it as a proper lexeme. Okay, then what you are going to do is return the token dot attribute, that is greater than, return the return token. Like this, a small code is there for relational operator transition diagram. So this is about a lexical analyzer. Here this second module completes now. Very interesting and very important module, guys. Please don't ignore it. Whatever the topics I have explained, if you get any doubt, you please ask me, or else you can watch my videos. Okay. So very, very interesting, very, very important topics I am explaining. In fact, the next topic is also very important, because that next topic, next module is a syntax analysis. Second module was a lexical analysis, which is the first phase of your compilation process. The next module, third module, is a syntax analysis. That is a second phase of your lexical, compilation process. Okay, that is also very important. So don't neglect these all topics, whatever I am explaining. If you get any doubt, please ask me at any time. And please go through my videos whenever you are free at your home. Okay, so okay, then you can leave the meeting now. I end up the class today here, and in next class onwards, I start the next module, that is module number 3. Okay, and also, you know.